morning. Welcome on this Mother's Day Sunday, and we welcome all of those who are watching, perhaps from home as well today. It's a day when we especially welcome mothers, grandmothers, stepmothers, and people who've been like mothers to kids who need love, support, encouragement, and wisdom. But it'll be good. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you that we have this day today to reflect on your goodness, to reflect on those whom you have used to show us the way, to support us, to love and encourage us in the good times and the difficult ones. We thank you, Lord, for your love, which is shed abroad in our hearts. Be with us today as we worship together. We pray in Jesus' name. Please stand and join me in the call to worship. How priceless is your unfailing love, O God. They feast on the abundance of your house. For with you is the fountain of life. Continue your love to those who know you. Pray together. Lord, we're grateful for your word, a message that comes to us through the lives of others, a message that we hear in our hearts, and a message that we see in print before us. Help us to find new meaning in the stories and new truth in your commandments. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. It's one of only two books in the Bible, of course, that is named for women. And I'll give you a little background on the reading today. Ruth lived in the country of Moab. Naomi, her mother-in-law, was from Israel. And Moab and Israel were not friendly countries to each other. Israel, of course, worshiped God. Excuse me. And Moab had other gods that they worshiped. So that was the first problem. But also, they had had wars over the years about resources, boundaries, you know, the things that countries have wars over. And so, the reason that Naomi and her husband ended up in Moab, a foreign country, was because there had been a great famine in Israel. And many of the Jews had heard that there was plenty of food, plenty of rain, good crops in Moab, and so they had made the journey there over time, simply to survive. At the time that we're reading about, Naomi and her husband had lived in Moab for quite some time. They'd lived there long enough to have a couple of sons who had grown to adulthood. And so this is where we pick up in Ruth chapter 1, starting with verse 3. Now Elimelech, Naomi's husband, died, and she was left with her two sons. They married Moabite women, one named Orpah and the other Ruth. After they'd lived there about 10 years, both Mahlon and Chilion died, and Naomi was left without her two sons and without her husband. When Naomi heard in Moab that the Lord had come to the aid of his people by providing food for them, she and her daughters-in-law prepared to return home from there. With her two daughters-in-law, she left the place where she had been living and set out on the road that would take them back to the land of Judah. Then Naomi said to her daughters-in-law, "Go back, each of you, to your mother's home. May the Lord show you kindness as you've shown to your dead husbands and to me. May the Lord grant that each of you will find rest in the home of another husband." Then she kissed them goodbye, and they wept aloud and said to her, "We will go back with you to your people." But Naomi said, "Return home, my daughters. Why would you come with me? Am I going to have any more sons who could become your husbands? Return home, my daughters. I'm too old to have another husband. Even if I had a husband tonight and then gave birth to sons, would you wait till they grew up? Would you remain unmarried for them? No, my daughters. It is more bitter for me than for you, because the Lord's hand has turned against me." At this, they wept aloud again. Then Orpah kissed her mother-in-law goodbye, but Ruth clung to her. "Look," said Naomi, "your sister-in-law is going back to her people and her gods. Go back with her." But Ruth replied, "Don't urge me to leave or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go, and where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. Where you die, I will die, and there I will be buried. May the Lord deal with me, be it ever so severely, if even death separates you and me." When Naomi realized that Ruth was determined to go with her, she stopped urging her. So the two women went on until they came to Bethlehem. When they arrived in Bethlehem, the whole town was stirred because of them. And the women exclaimed, "Can this be Naomi?" A couple of other words about the conventions of the time. The idea was that if a young woman was widowed, she should marry again, and someone who was a relative of the deceased husband should marry her. It was a kind of an obligation. And so what Naomi has been saying is, don't stick with me. I don't have any more sons who would marry you and look after you. Start a new life. Stay here in Moab. Don't make this journey with me to Israel. Somebody else, you know, go home, stay with your mom. Somebody else will marry you. Our second reading is from Matthew 22, verses 34 to 40, and I'm reading from the New International Version. Hearing that Jesus had silenced the Sadducees, the Pharisees got together. One of them, an expert in the law, tested him with this question, "Teacher, which is the greatest commandment in the law?" Jesus replied, "Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. And the second is like it. Love your neighbor as yourself. All the law and the prophets hang on these two commandments." This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Please pray with me. Lord, we ask that you be with us today, that we will hear your voice, that we will be encouraged, that we will be touched. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart, Lord, be edifying unto you, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. It's Mother's Day. Allison Cook said, "A mom's job is to feed you, clothe you, and make you afraid to touch anything." We often romanticize motherhood, especially on a day like today. And yes, mothers are a source of love, and they can create a safe space for us. But motherhood isn't always lovely. Comedy writer Jessie Klein, in her new book of essays, talks honestly about being a mother and losing herself. She says, all of the things you do, the clothes you wear, the way you think about yourself, has to explode away because the child is so all-encompassing. Your body doesn't look the same as it did before. You're so busy keeping that little person alive that a lot of vanity and making nice with other people goes away. And she says that when a new baby is born, it's like a bomb goes off in your house and in your marriage. The number of things to fight about multiplies exponentially. And a lot of you probably remember that. That's not to throw cold water on motherhood. It is to say that mothers are amazing, persistent people who just keep pushing forward, doing their best. Motherhood is hard. There are good moments, but there are very difficult ones, whatever the age of your kids. Mothers demonstrate resilience. They're resilient as they care for their children, feed their children, deal with crises, especially those teenage crises. They're resilient as they do usually these days an outside job in addition to trying to keep the household together. They're resilient as they try to make the money stretch, as they try to keep the house presentable, and maybe even mow the lawn. Today we're going to think about what we can learn from these women. And I'll have a couple of examples to share. First, I'd like to invite you to think about a woman in your family who overcame great challenges. If you're sitting near someone, and most of you are, just mention that lady's name to someone sitting next to you. Tell someone her name. Think for a moment to yourself. What have you learned from her? The person I think of is my grandma. And she had an interesting challenge ahead of her at a certain point. They lived in western Nebraska, in a small town in western Nebraska. Flat, kind of an area, surrounded by farms. If you've ever driven across Nebraska, how many of you have driven across Nebraska? Yeah, it goes on forever, doesn't it? It's all the same. It goes on and on. Well, Way out there in the on and on was where my grandparents lived. And my grandfather owned the furniture store in town. The Depression came, and he had extended credit to people. He, of course, lost any real business because people didn't have money. Along with the Depression, and some of you probably remember this, came a great drought in the Midwestern plains, and crops failed, and people lost their livestock, and basically farmers had nothing. As a result, my grandfather went broke. He lost the store. And as I have listened to the story, I believe he became seriously depressed. My grandparents had lived in a lovely, very large home. Grandma, at that point, had three kids. And all she knew was that she needed to hold on to that home and keep the family going. Grampy couldn't get another job. There were no jobs. And so the first thing Grandma did was go to the bank, which took some courage. You know, in those days, men did business. Women didn't. But she went to the bank and worked out something with the banker. I would guess that probably it was she'd pay interest only or something like that. We've seen those kinds of arrangements more recently. But she worked out a deal to where she could make only the smallest of payments. She then started to take in sewing for people. She was a marvelous seamstress. And, which would have been embarrassing for her, she started to take in lodgers in the home. Young women would rent a room and she would, she would provide meals for them as well. And so she made enough to get the family through a number of years until finally my grandfather was able to get a new job and they moved to Omaha. I heard her story a number of times. And what her story did for me, it became a touchstone. Because when I went through difficult times, I knew what to do. You put one foot in front of the other, you negotiate, you talk, and you work very hard. And I always had the faith that because my grandmother had done it, I could do it too. Many of you probably have had that same kind of example. A lady in your family showed courage, which allowed you to be able to show courage when you had. We have another example, a biblical example, of course, in the story of Ruth. As a widow, Ruth was left with nothing. Women didn't own property in biblical times. Men did. In Old Testament times, it was expected that widows would be looked after by their relatives. But what if they didn't have any male relatives to look after them? If they lacked male relatives, they would have struggled in terrible poverty. That was Naomi's experience. After her husband and both of her sons died, she was going to be by herself with no resources at all. So she decided she would go back to Israel. At least there was food there. And the custom was that there would be some offerings to help support impoverished widows. But she urged her daughters-in-law, very appropriately, to return to their families. That's what they were supposed to do, and their families would look after them. And Naomi said she would fend for herself. Now we remember, Ruth was from Moab. Naomi was from Israel. And the countries had conflict over beliefs and over territory. Naomi intended to return to Israel, her homeland, and Ruth, as a foreigner, especially a foreigner from Moab, would not have been well received there. But Ruth was willing to give up the security of remaining in her own country in order to look after Naomi as she returned to Israel. I wonder what Ruth must have felt. Love, loyalty, maybe responsibility for her mother-in-law. Here's an elderly lady. Didn't want to leave her alone. And so Ruth is going to sacrifice everything for the sake of her mother-in-law. Their journey wouldn't have been safe, and it would be hard. The trip would have been long, about 1,800 miles. It would have been shorter as the crow flies, but the Dead Sea comes up between a portion of Israel and Moab. And so they had to go up and around and down. So it was a very long journey, and it wasn't an easy journey. Moab is mountainous, so they had to deal with walking in mountains. And then there's desert between Israel and Moab. And most of you have probably had the experience of walking in sand. It's tough. Two women alone would have faced dangers, even if they had joined a caravan, which in all probability they would have. But Ruth was resolute, despite the difficulty of the journey, or maybe because she knew how difficult the journey would be for her mother-in-law. She was going to go, out of love and loyalty. And she chose to do this even as she was dealing with her own grief as a widow. Was she afraid? Probably. The women might have wondered whether they would have enough resources to survive that journey. And what would happen when they got to Bethlehem? Many of you know how disabling grief can be. It can be hard even to think, to do the things that should be done every day. Sometimes it feels like you can't even breathe, like your energy's gone. But somehow, Ruth found the energy to make that journey. Life hadn't treated Ruth well, but we don't hear her complain. It appears as well that she became a believer at some point, because she did speak of God. And so there must have been some germ of faith inside her that said, you can do this, Ruth. Trust God. So she was resilient. She literally put one foot in front of the other. And she did it out of love. Self-sacrifice for love. It's what mothers do, isn't it? Now, ultimately, the story ended well. Ruth and Naomi made it to Judah. When they got there, interestingly, Naomi discovered or remembered that there was a male relative named Boaz who was related to her late husband. So remember, the rules were, if there's a widow, a young widow, she should remarry. And there was kind of an obligation for a near relative to marry a young widow if he was single. So Naomi explains to Ruth how she might meet the guy. You know, go out in this field that's been cut, and they always would leave some grain in the fields. Go out there, glean, pick up grain that's been left, and you'll make this guy's acquaintance, in a word. She found favor with Boaz. And after a little bit of who should marry her kind of stuff, which you would read in the book of Ruth, Boaz marries Ruth. She's rewarded for all the courage she has shown. Interestingly, she has a son, and down over the generations, David is born in that family line, and we all remember that Jesus also is from the family of David. And so when we reflect on it, Ruth's choice, her courageous choice, made her a member of the line of our Savior. We don't know the influence we will have. We don't know the legacy we will leave. All we know is what we're called to do now. What drove Ruth and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and so many women since then to carry on in spite of challenges? Love. Mothers teach us about love. As we read in Matthew 22, Jesus tells us to love one another. When love is strong, we can forget our own pains and our own problems as we put others first. And in my experience, the pains and problems then become less important because I'm busy thinking about someone else and how I can be helpful to them. The question I would pose today, for whom are you going to make a difference? To whom can you give a hand? To whom can you show amazing Christian love? For all that you've done already, for all of the lives that you've touched already, thank you. I believe that the Lord is up there saying, thank you. But the bottom line is, none of us is done yet. There are still more lives to touch, still more people to help, still more broken hearts to heal, still more lonely people to companion with, still more kids who need to hear stories, still more who just need to be loved. Let's go out today thinking and talking about the great ladies who've helped and influenced us. And then let us do likewise, trusting God, loving unreasonably, and making lives better around us. Are there announcements today?
I have two over here. First one is the deacons have brought some flowers to church today for any of you who consider yourselves a mother. And so that's a pretty broad definition. Could be a fur baby's mother. It could be an aunt. It could be a sister. Anybody who's been motherly. And then we also have some birthdays. Diane Nelson's birthday is on the 11th, and Les Mallory's birthday is also on the 11th, and he is here. You know what that means, Les. Get ready. Get ready.
Prayers for the family of Susie Martin. She passed away this last week.
Joys or concerns? We certainly can be joyful for the lovely flowers that we see out there, the glorious spring weather, at last, I would say. And joyful for the fellowship we have together. Let us pray. Lord, you've heard our joyful hearts, even if the words have not been spoken. And you've heard our concerns. We pray that you will be with those who are grieving, that you will make yourself known as the comforter. We pray that you will give resilience and hope, strength and love to everyone here and to those we know and care about. We pray for resilience for the folks of the Ukraine, for folks dealing with the residue of COVID, for people dealing with financial challenges, for those who are fearful for any reason. Help us, Lord, to show resilience as we work with you to rebuild the church so that more and more people's lives can be touched and served. We're praying together today, Lord, the prayer that you taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Go forth today, renewed and courageous, to love as you have been loved, to care for others as you have been cared for. And may the Lord give you courage, compassion, his wisdom. May you always sense his presence with you.